Anyways, I guess because I haven't been doing too many samples, which is kind of funny because like listening to your show, you do tons and tons of music, and that's what I try to get from all the guests I have. And a lot of people are like, oh, I don't know, I don't really listen to anything. So, do you have any songs? And don't worry about copyright. So, just any people, like I heard you liked Primus and Tool. I've heard a lot of people say that Tool has a lot of like red-pilled lyrics, or it could be interpreted that way. So, is there any like bands or songs that come to mind that you think like now you look back on it and you're like, oh God, that's such a red-pilled kind of meaning?
I think the Tool definitely has some of that. There's a line that I was just thinking of: "Liar, lawyer, mirror, show me what's the difference."
Who are you to wave your finger? You must have been out your hair. I hold deep in muddy waters. You practically raised.
Thank you. I think one of my favorite bands, and when I was talking about when I was talking about music that I think will be studied in the future that is worthy of that kind of thing, a couple bands that come to mind for me are Pink Floyd and Tool. And I actually kind of think of Tool as almost like the 90s nihilistic American version of Pink Floyd. They were almost kind of expressing the same energy, but at a different period in time, with a different level of intensity. But I really love Tool's music. And I think for me, like, the level of virtuosity to me is very white. It's very European. And I think that that always really appealed to me. It was almost mechanized, not in the way that it's not, you know, that it's, oh, it's not organic, it doesn't feel good, they're too stiff or something like that, but just that they're so well practiced and just so talented that they can so consistently produce those sounds, you know. Yet at the same time, the music really evolves very gradually, and like the pieces flow in and out of each other, and it's very organic in the way it's composed. And I think they're one of the few groups that actually is a genuine band, in the sense that they all like bring this unique thing and to the table, and they're able to make it all meld together in a very organic way. It's not just like some guy brings a song necessarily and everyone just, you know, kind of puts their thing around what he did. Like, their stuff is interwoven, and I've always loved their stuff. And also, you know, this actually speaks to one of your earlier points. You were saying that, you know, I was talking about, we want positive stuff, you know, but like I said, not necessarily like Kumbaya Ned Flanders stuff, but I've always found that Tool and Pink Floyd too, they both confront very heavy topics. Especially Tool. I mean, they talk about child molestation. Like, the song Prison Sex is about child molestation. And the rumor is that the lead singer, Maynard, I don't know how much you know about this, but the rumor is that he was molested as a child. And so he has a couple of songs where he kind of alludes to that. But Prison Sex, very specifically, if you kind of analyze the lyrics, is about that. We'll be right back. So, I mean, they just run at these very heavy topics just headlong. And it's the kind of thing you should be really angry about, you know? And I think they do a great job of confronting that directly. Now, at the same time, I think they've also been, you know, they've been pretty degenerate. And I think they've also been part of the, you know, they kind of get pulled into the 90s, like atheist whole thing like that. And but I still feel like they were always about questioning things. They're about questioning authority. And I think that's the place from which their kind of atheistic kind of views and things come from. So I always kind of cut them slack on that because, you know, they basically try to get people to follow their own instincts. And a lot of their music is about that. And I think it's very, their music is very much an expression, I think, of the Faustian spirit, you know, in that it's like, let's see how far we can take this. And like I said before, the virtuosity, like Maynard's voice is incredible. And then you have, and his lyrics are incredible. He's a very, very deep thinking kind of guy. And there's a lot of, if you start really analyzing his lyrics, there's a lot of layers of meaning in them. You know, it's never like a lot of dual or double meanings of words and that kind of thing. one of their other really woke songs, I was trying to think of another one. There's one called Hooker with a Penis, which is on the album Onima. And that song is just like the biggest middle finger to like corporate consumerism that I've ever heard. It's awesome. If people have not heard that song, and you might hear the name Hooker with a Penis, like, oh, that's degenerate or whatever. But I think kind of the main meaning of it, or my interpretation of it, is basically like, you're not getting what you paid for. Like, you get a hooker and then turns out she has a penis. But the lyrics of that song are absolutely brilliant.
Thank you.
But yeah, they're one of my favorite bands, probably the favorite band. And they were there. I feel like they really tapped into the zeitgeist of the time, and that's what I think great artists do.
Mm. So speaking of the times, you said that in another interview you were talking about that you started out with bass, and a lot of the bands, you know, so it seems like you're Gen Z, or was it Gen X? Yeah, Gen X. So were you a fan of Primus and Faith No More at all, or any of those bands?
Yeah, I'm right on the cusp of millennial and Gen Z. I'm literally right on the line. So I have a younger and an older sibling. So I kind of have a foot in both camps. I love Primus. Primus is also, that was actually my original, like I started playing the bass because of Les Claypool. I never heard anybody play. I mean, you usually don't even notice the bass, you know, like I'd never really noticed the bass because it's a kind of a background instrument. Traditionally, it just kind of, it's the bridge between the rhythm, the drums and the guitar and the piano. And it's kind of just there to hold that things down. But, you know, Les Claypool had this style, which, I mean, nobody plays like Les Claypool and nobody ever will. Like, it's such a unique style. It's very percussive. And it's also, you know, I'm a rural Midwesterner, so he also has this like country twang in his voice, but also the way he plays the bass, it's like country prog funk. It's this just wild style of playing. And he also sings about cars, like rebuilding cars. He's got, and Jerry was a race car driver. He's got a Chevy 2 Nova in the video. And I actually used to have a Chevy 2 Nova, 1964.
Karen,
So I grew up and we had, you know, like muscle cars and stuff, and we used to rebuild engines and whatnot. So like not only just his playing style really appealed to me, but just also the themes of what Primus was writing about. And I think that his playing style matched that because it was very masculine. You know, you don't hear that. It was very aggressive, you know, so it really appealed to me, you know, when I was a young guy. Like I first started falling in love with Primus when I was in like seventh or eighth grade. I got Sailing the Seas of Cheese. And the other thing about them is they're funny. They have a good sense of humor. And, you know, like they would get people at shows to chant Primus sucks. Like it's a joke. It's an inside joke that, you know, Primus fans say Primus sucks because they don't take themselves super seriously, even though, you know, they know they're badass. They're another case, much like Tool and Pink Floyd. They're all what I would call like prog rock. You know, it's like progressive, it's experimental, and same deal there. And Primus has an incredible virtuosity, not just Les Claypool, but also Tim Alexander, the drummer. He used to play with the Blue Man Group as well after he played with Primus. Like he's just an incredible percussionist and drummer, and just an incredible talent all around. And then I can't remember his last name, but Larry Lalonde, the guitar player for Primus. And they did have somewhat of a rotating cast, but I think that was the original core, although some people came in and out. But they were incredible. And in that moment in time, again, they were kind of nailing it. Their stuff doesn't have quite the depth lyrically or conceptually that Tool does, but although Les Claypool did do a lot of Pink Floyd stuff, they Primus actually covered Have a Cigar on one of their EPs called Miscellaneous Debris. They do a really cool version. I actually prefer their version of Have a Cigar. But and then he did also, he did the entire Animals album, and when he was doing like Les Claypool solo stuff. So there's kind of an intermingling there of musicians. And actually, I think Tim Alexander might have also played for A Perfect Circle. There's another connection there. But all those guys are just, you know, incredibly talented musicians. And I think same thing with Les Claypool. Like he comes off to me as like, I guess he was a carpenter before he was in Primus. So he's a very down to earth kind of guy, and you know that's why he sings about like blue collar kind of stuff. And but he has that, I think, Faustian kind of spirit. And he was interesting kind of how he handled the business side. He like Frank Zappa, also an interesting character. But he, you know, Les Claypool created his own kind of like business structure. It has his own kind of label, and I always kind of respected that element and studied him in that way too, like how he kind of handled his career in general, because he kind of kept it to where he was able to do kind of whatever he wanted. And he was always kind of the center of a universe of all these talented people and all these projects he was working on. You know, he even did a wine thing for a while, like Maynard did. And he's done a little bit of filmmaking, you know, so he's a very interesting character.
I like what you're saying about these guys, Primus not taking themselves too serious. And I think it goes along with what you're saying. I'd heard you say it as well in different interviews you've done. You like to, I guess you like to be cheesy, corny, or I guess the word you used was like whimsical. And it was, yeah, man. So, but the thing that I thought was interesting, and it was kind of counterintuitive, and I thought, that's actually kind of insightful, and I never thought of it that way, is that it actually takes balls and, you know, to let yourself be not ironic and say like, hey, I'm going to do a song about love, but it's going to be, you know, sarcastic, and it's going to be like a critique of love song. No, just literally just be cheesy and just like, just let yourself be vulnerable, and that's all good art. And so, yeah, man, like, I think we have been programmed to just, you know, be detached and just like, you know, individualist, materialist. It's just like, no, we don't even let yourself get into that. And it's actually kind of sad that we're there. And I didn't even think about that. until you'd said it and go, you know, that's true with me as well. Like I love to sing when I'm alone, but like the only way I'll sing around people is if I have to, you know, it's like a cheesy, like, I'm kind of being goofy. Like, and it's, not like, but you know what I mean? In the ironic goofy, not like literally like, no, I'm going to embrace the, yeah, I guess, I don't mean like, I, that's the thing is that there's a lack of vocab for this. Like, it's like to be sincerely vulnerable, but in a, yeah, I don't know. Like, I guess, yeah, whimsical. I guess there's no other way to say it than whimsical, you know? So I think it's cool when bands are willing to do that.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's like authenticity maybe is a good word. Not maybe not the best, the perfect word, but yeah, just it is. And I completely identify with what you're saying there, because I had, in discovering my own voice, I went through this whole process of kind of being afraid to really sing like I sing. So I was always kind of emulating other people's singing styles. Like for a while, I kind of tried to sound like Tom York of Radiohead or, you know, whoever I was listening to. I've definitely got a Maynard kind of thing that I do a little bit, even though my style is very different. I always gravitated toward the way that he sings and the way that he accents certain words and things. And so, yeah, I went through this whole process of trying to find my voice, and I would even kind of strain my voice trying to sound like other people. It was almost like an identity crisis. And then my little brother, he was just like, you know, you always sound like you're just trying to sound like somebody else. Why don't you just sound like yourself? Like, why don't you just sing how you sing? And I just needed someone, kind of like what you're saying, like, I just needed someone to just like point that out to me, you know? And I was like, oh, I kind of just needed someone to give me permission or make me aware that I was doing that, because I wasn't, you know, I wasn't kind of aware that I was doing that. So, you know, that's kind of when I really first started discovering my voice. And I feel like I've figured out what works, my voice works on now. I kind of do, I think my Americana kind of stuff works well, because I have kind of a Midwestern accent, and just kind of in that pocket of like Tom Petty, like John Mellencamp, kind of a little bit country, you know, but a little bit folky. And but yeah, I can definitely relate to what you're saying. And I think that is a way that we've all been programmed, that it's like kind of like white people can't dance. You know, we're just afraid to be authentically ourselves because we've been programmed, and a lot of it is unspoken. It's just something you see in a movie where, oh, the white guy, you know, he can't sing, he can't do this, white man can't jump, like all these, it's all these things white men can't do, right? So we've kind of been programmed to not be willing to be ourselves. And also we're in a harsh environment, yeah, where we're going to get criticized and we're going to, you know, kind of shrink back. That's why I try to create that environment where it is positive. And hey, if I got to be the guy that steps out to be cheesy or whimsical, and you know, I'm happy to do that. And really, I think that the word cheesy, speaking of that and tying it all with the Primus thing, of course, when he says cheesy, like he's using like the 80s, 90s, you know, idea, which is still the definition that people think of it. But I really think the term cheesy has kind of come to mean like anytime you're being really authentic and sincere about your feelings. Like you said, we've been trained to always have this level of detachment. Like we don't want people to really know what we think or feel. And I don't, you know, and I mean, of course it's okay to, I think it's healthy to have some layer of reservation with people depending on how well you know them and that kind of thing. But I think that it's too much that we've been pushed in that direction. And so, you know, I think it is important to get back to a place where we can really encourage positive, those just like genuine, authentic feelings, you know, I think the two songs that I've got out there right now, Love Your People and Porcelain Doll, I feel like both of those are something I wouldn't have been able to do a few years ago, because, and I've always been, I mean, my stuff has always been like pretty, I think, authentic in as far as like I'm willing to put myself out there. But I went even further into the realm of, you know, something I wouldn't have done in the past because it would be perceived as not being hip. And really, when they say it's not hip, really they just mean it's like white. It's something white people would do. So I think there's a very serious deprogramming that we need to have in that respect, so that we can get back to creating really great art. Because I think we're self-censoring ourselves out of a fear of, you know, not being cool. But, you know, what does cool even mean? It's a Judeo-African concept to begin with.
Judeo-African. I've never heard that phrase before. But so you'd said that white people can't jump. And that reminded me of the literal movie of the same title, White Men Can't Jump, when Spike Lee, I mean, he was still being anti-white, but it was more balanced back then, I guess. And one of my favorite scenes in the movie is where, I don't know, what I forgot the actor's name, the white guy in it. They're driving a car together.
Hey, what is this?
Jimi Hendrix.
No, I know who it is, but why are you playing Jimmy?
Well, because I like to listen to him.
Oh, you like to listen? That's what the fucking problem is. Y'all listen.
Well, what am I supposed to do, eat it?
No. You're supposed to hear it.
Hey, well, I just said I like to listen to it, man.
No. There's a difference between hearing and listening. See, white people, y'all can't hear Jimmy. You listen.
What the fuck are you talking about? His drummer was white.
Get the fuck out of here. Jimi Hendrix's drummer was not white.
Yes, he did. Yo, check it out. See?
This is a picture.
Whole damn band is white except for Jimmy.
This is a fucking picture, man. This is airbrush bullshit. Jimi Hendrix did not have a white rhythm section. You cannot hear Jimmy.
And so he kind of put him in his place, saying, like, dude, you're just as racist against us, and this is a bullshit misconception. Like, that actually had a good like unifying theme of the movie. Like the whole thing was like, you know, and it's fantasy, I get it, you know, that's harmful in its own way to feed the myth that multiculturalism works and all this bullshit, but still at least it wasn't so bad. And I thought that's 100% true. And I think part of it too is yeah, trying to be something that we're not. Of course you're going to be goofy if you are trying to dance like a black person, you know, you're trying to twerk or whatever, like it just doesn't really fit. I think a lot of it overlaps, you know, but all right, man. The thing I like to always ask people is basically to be stoic, is what are things that you think are a waste of time that is just, you know, part of the thing that I like about your podcast and what I'm trying to do with mine is not be like every right winger podcast where it's just like the daily outrage, you know, or like the weekly outrage. Like, can you believe that they, you know, the smug kid smiling and the Indian goes in his face, whatever. You know, instead of spending and wasting all your energy chasing the, you know, like a cat chasing a laser pointer or whatever, like what should we focus our energy on? Things that we can actually change. Some people argue that voting doesn't actually matter. I think everybody has their own opinions. So obviously, like what we've mainly been focusing on is like art and how to change the culture and stuff. But this applies to anything, literally just the political spectrum, what you value in life. Basically, for people who share our values and I don't know all your values, but, you know, we see eye to eye on a lot. For people who want to do what's best for their people and make a difference, you know, to make America not a shithole and just, you know, devolving into a demographic decline and, you know, South Africa, people who don't want that, what would you suggest is something that is useful, that some things that are within their control, like it's useful to spend their time and focus on? And what are things that are just a waste of their time? That it's like, dude, just drop it. You're just spending useless energy getting angry about this when you have no control over it.
Yeah, I think one of the things that we probably don't do enough is I think like where we're spending our money, because a lot of people we're still like most of this we're like voluntarily engaging in. So, you know, a lot of people are still subscribed to Netflix and Amazon and all these kind of things, and they could live without these kind of things, you know, and boycotting any. And I know it's hard because almost everything is a chain store now, so it's almost impossible to not sometimes get a coffee at Starbucks or something. But I do think like we could probably all stand to be more disciplined and like making sure that we put our like we're investing or not investing our money in these people who are trying to destroy us. That's just a way where I see like a lot of people are just like, oh, well, you know, I still go here, and I know people who are deep into the movement who have like a Netflix account. I'm like, what are you doing? You know, like, they hate us. I mean, Obama's on the board, and like, they're putting out a, you know, an LBGT, whatever the hell, for kids. Like, every other week, they've got a new like perverted thing for kids, you know. But anyway, that's just one thing. I think that's something that we, you know, but the thing about that is we have to create an alternative. We can't just say, hey, because entertainment and art is a need. So we can't just tell people not to do that. We do need to create an alternative. And I think the other thing is, and you've picked up on this from the way that I craft the message I try to put out on the Saturday Night live stream and on the podcast I go on, and also on my Twitter and Gab and all that stuff, is I would just tell people to be constructionist. I don't like the term, and a pro-actionary. I don't really like the term reactionary, because that basically insinuates that we're sitting around waiting for someone else to do something to us and we're going to react to it. I think it's a lot more important that we proactively figure out what is it that we need to do to make things better, and not wait for them, not wait for the next outrage story. Like, yeah, like you were saying, the Covington kids or whatever. There's always going to be another one, another news cycle with another outrage story. It's going to be one level worse. And I think it's fine that people do those, but I don't even pay any attention to that stuff anymore. You know, where they're like, can you believe that, blah, blah, you know, it's like, yes, I can. And they're going to keep doing it until we have the unity and the power to push back and force them not to do it. And that doesn't necessarily mean violence. It just means we just have to have like a unified message culturally, like via our news structure and legal, like you were talking about, you know, basically like having a legal team that will work with us, who's on our side. We need to get organized. And I think another thing that people can do besides just being constructive, like living that healthier lifestyle, don't just be a consumer, you know, be creating things. Yeah, have a family if you can, if you're in a position to do that. Get married and have a family and raise your kids understanding these things. Support people like you and like me who are doing this and putting ourselves out there, because obviously not everybody can do that. And, you know, it's a lot of work. I know that you're putting a lot of work into your site and into this podcast. And of course, I spend a lot of time. I like you pointed out, I don't have all the artists on the website because I can't even keep up with it, you know, which is good because I have enough people coming in, but I'm like one guy kind of managing all these different pieces, and it's hard to do. So supporting people who are putting ourselves out there is good.
Yeah, what you're saying, man, that's part of it is kind of inevitable unless you just straight up drop out of society and just live off the radar. Because like, actually, I felt proud of myself. I was just visiting the States, and my mom was complaining about how cable is insanely high, and now it's only boomers who are like, you know, you watch Fox News or something, these cable shows, and all the commercials are like, you know, are you using the wrong catheter? Is the catheter giving you, you know, like, it's all just old people, right? But they're just, you know, old habits kind of a thing. And my brothers and I have been trying to get her off cable for a long time, and finally it's just gotten so expensive that she's like, okay. And so I bought her a Chromecast, which I didn't know what that was. You know, I've been on my laptop and torrenting shit for 10 years at least. Like, just nobody in my generation watches, never mind the political reasons, I just don't want to deal with commercials anymore. So I don't even know what it was, but I looked up Chromecast. You hook it in, and basically it's just you put your laptop on the TV. It's pretty cheap. It's like 15 bucks, or I think it's like 40 bucks or something. I don't know, not that bad, right? And now she doesn't have cable, and I showed her, look, you can stream Fox News and all these places, you know, MSNBC, whatever, if you want to change it, all the channels, health, da, da, da. I was like, man, good for me. And then I told my brother, and he's like, Google, oh, Google's horrible. You support Google, don't support Google. I'm like, God damn it, dude. Like, there's no winning. Like, there's just these global homo corporations, you know, like, so, but you pick your battles kind of thing. Like, you can't just give up and say, well, you know, oh, well, I'm just going to give money to Netflix with their, you know, pedo movies and stuff, and Obama, as you're saying. So, yeah, every little bit helps. So the other question is, if you were like the dictator of America overnight, right? I'm a genie, I'm Robin Williams, and I just, you know, I make you the Führer of America. You have absolute control what would you do to fix, you know, the modern culture, the government, the international banking, entertainment? Like, what are things that you would do if you had absolute power overnight?
Wow, that's a big question. Well, are you talking about just as it relates to culture or just everything?
All the institutions. I mean, the podcasts, like you and I, obviously, we try to focus our energy on changing culture and art and stuff like that. But you don't have to. Like, what we're talking about can be anything. So, like, again, academia, banking, a lot of different things that I think a lot of right wingers see there's a lot of problems with.
I think the thing I would focus on is just decentralizing. So basically, like, you know, what Trump went in there and said he was going to, like, I'm going to cut this and shut this down. And then he never really cut anything. And the government just continues to grow and, you know, spend even more ridiculous amounts of money on things. And like, I'm currently working a job that's like a couple layers removed from like a government contractor. And it's amazing just the amount of waste that there is and how many like different contractors' bottom lines are being absorbed by the government. But I think the main thing I would focus on is just the like getting rid of programs that the federal government has no business to, and kicking those things back to the state level, because I'm very much, and this goes into the cultural realm also, I'm all about relocalization. Like, people should have more control over their culture locally. Like, you know, Hollywood shouldn't be the only one determining like what kind of films are made and distributed, etc. Like, I think there needs to be more of a leveled structure to where you've kind of got like a state level cultural institution and a more localized and cultural institutions and up to like the national level. But also, you know, like the Department of Education, like kick those things back to the state level, get all of these stupid programs, Department of Homeland Security gone, FBI needs to be cleaned out. If not abolished altogether, things like that. There's so much waste and redundancy, and it's like there's just we're funding this massive apparatus which is just being used to bludgeon us with, and literally, you know, they're invading our country. We can't even get. We're sending billions and billions and billions of dollars in aid to all these other countries. Israel is one of the biggest ones, but all of these countries, we're sending it all over Africa. We're sending it all over the Middle East, you know, and then we go there and we destroy their infrastructure, and then we pay to rebuild their stuff with private contractors, cut all that stuff, you know. And I guess speaking of the contractors and the Middle East and wars, that's the other thing too. Is like we have to draw back out of all of these places that we've been involved in for so many years. It's a complete waste of time. I don't think they have any intention of us ever leaving there. They're going to just milk our military and our tax dollars till we just collapse in on ourselves. So all of that stuff has to be done away with. There's no reason for us to be there anymore. And if it were for resources like oil or whatever, then I think they should just be more honest about it. And people would probably be more accepting, like, oh, we invaded because of their oil. Like, okay, we'll make sure it also benefits the citizens, which it hasn't at all, you know. But I mean, I could at least understand something on that level of, you know, that's how the world works. You got to go get resources and this kind of thing. And I could at least understand that. But they're screwing everybody. So, yeah, it's for me, just in general, it's about decentralizing power. And like I said, as that relates to the government, to economics, there's too many these giant monopolies, just like we're talking about also with, like, you know, Netflix and Amazon, totally out of control, censoring people, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, they have way too much power. And so it's all about figuring out how we're going to like relocalize control politically, economically, culturally. I think that is crucial.
Amen, man. I'm a big believer in thinking that the future, and this is my positive vision of the future, is that the United States needs to balkanize. And within a short period, I'm hoping things are going to go towards more states' rights while it's still the empire still exists. But if the empire collapses, I think, you know, we're the size of Europe, basically. And we're such a new country that it was pretty much a monolithic culture. But now that's starting to change, where even like, California and Texas. You know, a lot of Californians move to Texas and vote and change things, and the Texans are getting pissed, or whatever, Colorado or whatever, you know, even within our state. So I think, yeah, it's right now what's going on. And I don't like to focus on topical kind of stuff, but right now there's a whole Georgia abortion kind of thing that I think will definitely lead to states' rights. And I think it's a good thing. And so maybe we're headed in that direction, but I fear that we might need to collapse or have some sort of catastrophic event before things go that way. Because I think, all the white people, we, you know, especially American white people, it's in our pioneer individualist blood. We're all, you know, small government kinds of people, you know, the rugged individualist. And, but it's just not going to happen, you know, like just with voting patterns and stuff. So, but no, I agree 100%, man. And I think that's the thing that a lot of us got here. It's the libertarian to alt-right pipeline that seems counterintuitive to anybody who hasn't gone through it themselves. But it's basically like, I want small government. I want it. Leave me the fuck alone. Let me have my little backyard of guns and things. And you know, my neighbor can smoke weed. And then we realize that the only way to achieve that is in a homogenous society, you know, the Hans Hermann Hoppe kind of thing. And so, yeah, I don't know. Become Fuhrer and just cut the chase and get it going ASAP, man. So the other question I was going to ask you is, for people who are just getting red pilled and just kind of getting into this stuff, is there like either a handful or just a single piece of work? You know, this can be a book, it can be a documentary that you suggest specifically for the purpose, not for art necessarily, but to help them in the process of becoming red pilled. To see the truth, I guess. Is there anything that comes to mind that was really profound within your process that you, like, you know, you read or you watched or listened to and you thought, wow?
I think the greatest story never told is really good. And it's something that I've recommended to some people who were, you know, kind of more normie leaning, because even if you don't believe everything, it's just going to tell you this story of World War II and what happened from a totally different perspective than you've ever heard, because we've only been getting one perspective for at least like 60 years, the perspective of the communist. And so to get another perspective on that, I think is jarring in a positive way. And so I think that is probably something that I would recommend, that a lot of people could, of course it's kind of long, but it's worthwhile, because it kind of takes that kind of time to kind of help undo so many years of propaganda and programming. Because that really believing that about World War II, what a person believes about World War II and the Germans and the Americans, it's kind of the linchpin for our entire current political paradigm. So if you can kind of get underneath that and start changing a person's mind about that, and I think that's why so many people focus so heavily on that in the movement. And of course, you know, we get criticized for that too. And I don't focus on that, but I do think it's kind of the linchpin that, like, if that part is not what people have said that it is, then what else, like almost nothing else makes sense in the current, you know, narrative of the mainstream. So I think that's probably one of the best things to get people red pilling. And it was a big thing for me.
Right on. Yeah. I downloaded it, but yeah, it's long. I haven't finished it, I'm not going to lie. So I think more than halfway through. And I think what comes to mind is Stone Toss. There's a cartoon where it's like a hippie kind of boomer guy who's like, yeah, open your mind, dude. And then the kid starts to question, like, I don't know, the Holocaust. And he's like, whoa, take it easy. Not that much. And I thought, yeah, man. So I thought it was a perfect analogy, because I had that same thing. All these teachers, all these Marxist fucking baby boomers brainwashed me from day one of school, saying, you know, like the winners write the history books, and, you know, take the other position, you know, open your mind, you know, walk a mile in their shoes. And we're always taught from the Native Americans' perspective and how white man is totally revisionist history, yada. And so we're beaten over the head about that. And so one thing I've asked people to do is just, yeah, like you said, even if not everything's true, just to even embrace that as a possibility. That was not an option. And I used to think I was pretty open-minded and I would question everything. Da-da-da. And when I had actually, I mean, that's such a far leap for people to even question it, you know? So yeah, I agree 100%. And yeah, I need to finish that. I think it's a good one. Cool. Well, I appreciate it. We're coming up on like 2 hours plus all the music and stuff. This is gonna be a long ass podcast, so I guess we'll close here. I appreciate your time, and now is the time to shill all of the stuff that you do. What are some things that, you know, if people are, you know, they like this interview, they want to get into your stuff, what are a few things that you'd suggest that you're kind of proud of, that people should check out?
You mean my stuff personally or like White Art Collective people?
Well, I guess both. Specifically, I was talking about you and your projects. So, you know, obviously the site, like where people can find you, I'll put everything in the show notes, you know, your Gab, Twitter, everything. But yeah, specifically stuff that you've created. And I guess, yeah, sure. People within the White Art Collective that you're particularly proud of. A guy I heard that I really liked was Saint Friendship. He's awesome. And I just heard of him, so I can't think of any songs particularly besides Brother that I thought was awesome.
Don't you know we're running out of time? Oh, there's gonna be a reckoning. Yeah, we're sitting round the table. Oh, hand in hand. Speaking in tongues, chanting and carrying on. Oh, raising the dead and the long gone. Now I get it was a game. My blood is aflame. It's funny 'cause I got my daddy's name. And up to now I thought it was a shame. Are you a brother of mine? Do you feel? Yeah, we're running out of time. Oh, there's gonna be a reckoning. Do you know how history is written? Yeah, it's like a run-on sentence. It's like some stuff gets done and then some other stuff's gotta come from it. We call it cause and consequence. Are you a brother of mine? Do you feel me? Maybe I'm talking out of line. Just tell me if you feel me.
But yeah, so I guess, yeah, people that you're proud of, things that you're proud of yourself, for people who just want to get into it.
Cool, yeah. So for me personally, I've just got a couple of songs out there under this project, but I really like Porcelain Doll. That one was super a big deal for me production wise, and I worked with my buddy Chuck Miller in the studio. We were both very proud of that, and I think it has an important message about kind of reconnecting women back with their instinct to want to be a mother and a wife.
Remember how you told me when you were a girl? You thought having a baby the most beautiful thing in the world. What happened to you, darling? You seem so lost. You wander around drunk on wine with your eyes all glossed.
Ooh.
So I'm particularly proud of that one. And that's, you can check that out over on the White Art Collective site. If you go to artist, you can find me on there, Jeff Winston. And some artists that I'm particularly, I mean, of course, I love all of our artists, but I think some that would probably appeal to a very broad audience. The Decency is incredible. He's very talented. He's got an album called Red Pill Music that I think you could share with some pretty normie people, and I think they could get on board with it. It's really high production quality, and he's also just an incredibly talented songwriter. He really knows how to craft a great pop song. And as he and I have talked about this, he's not shy about having some propaganda in there, or as I like to call it, popaganda. So he's definitely worth checking out. And then also, like you said, Saint Friendship. He's got an incredible voice. The guy's incredibly talented. He's a great find. I'm excited just to be able to, you know, try to spread his music out there more. More people need to be aware of him and the Decency. Two incredible talents. And the Mamas and the Pepes are awesome too. They're so much fun. And Mama has an incredible voice. She actually sang with me on the Porcelain Doll song. So that was an honor that she was willing to collaborate there. But yeah, I recommend all of our artists, but those three are like some of our like feature folks, and they're great people and easy to work with. So yeah, we're on Gab, we're on Twitter, I'm on Wire, I'm on Telegram, obviously the website, whiteartcollective.com. We have a store over there where we sell all kinds of music. We got a couple books. We're about to put out some shirts. We're going to do a limited run of some shirts that I'm excited about. One of our artists is designing those, so those should be coming out in the next few weeks or so. And yeah, so we do our Saturday night live stream on our YouTube channel every Saturday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, and we feature artists, and we're all the time adding new music. We had The Darkest Sky, and was a new artist that we'd never played on there before, and we also had Jack White is an up-and-coming, like, kind of country folk artist that I'm really excited about. I just became aware of him, but I think he's going to be – he's got big potential. And Uber Folk, too. They're also awesome. Got to throw that in there.
Right on. Cool. Well, I appreciate it. And, yeah, I guess I'll play some of the artists that you just mentioned as an outro. And, yeah, I appreciate your time, and I'll have to catch you next time.
Sounds great, man. Thank you so much for having me on. It's a pleasure talking to you.
Likewise. Have a good one, man.
You too.
Hey, you think if I land this successfully, Lab School will give me a job as a pilot?
You know, I think they would give you a job doing anything if you could pull this off.
Yeah, right. Nah, I'm a white guy.
Tumbled and soared far from the herd. woke up this morning and the newsman told me I didn't work for nothing, all of my kind. He said, it's my skin lets me win. They say it's my pride. They say I got privilege. Well, I'm not gonna hide. Oh, this is my home. Oh, this is my home. My friend went to college, and the teachers all told her that we have no culture, just what we stole, they said. It's our skin, let us win. They say it's my pride. They say I got privilege. Well, I'm not gonna hide. Oh, this is my home. Oh, this is my home. Don't need trigger warning or a phony safe space. They'll cower inside them and say it's my fault. They'll say it's my skin did them in. They say it's my pride. They say I got privilege. Well, I'm not gonna hide. This is my home. They say it's our pride. They say we got privilege. Well, we're not gonna hide. 'Cause this is our home. Oh, this is our
home. Suspension like heavenly flakes birthing at the surface of her tender pale skin, the sound of our children's voices rings the air, the little rumble caused by their running reverberates my spine. It's okay to be white. It's okay to be white. My wife rises to dance with me. We go together in the light. The little ones around us below, singing out their heart's delight. And out in the garden, I've been laboring the fragrance of the grass. Fills our noses.
children's faces light up.